derives from various weapons arts, including the art of the samurai sword. Aikido's founder, Morihei Ueshiba Sensei, who lived from 1883 to 1969, studied many weapon systems and incorporated their insight into the art that he developed. Tsugi Satome Sensei is a direct student of Sensei. Born in Japan in 1937, Satome Sensei began his study of Aikido at the age of 19. In 1960, he entered Aikikai Honbu Dojo, headquarters of Aikido Central Organization, as an Uchichi, or live-in student, a position that he held for 15 years. While O-sensei rarely, if ever, offered systematic training in sword technique, he did often perform spontaneous demonstrations of his sword skills. Several of his students, including Saotome Sensei, have attempted to systematize what they took to be the basic lessons of those demonstrations. Saotome Sensei also trained under O-sensei's son, Kisumaru Ueshiba Sensei, Aikido's present Doshu. Like Doshu, Saotome Sensei has stated that Aikido's basic purpose is to help people live better, to make their spirits blossom, and so to improve the world. Saotome Sensei often traveled with O-sensei and served as his uki in demonstrations. For about 6 years after the founder's death, Saotome Sensei stayed on as an instructor at Honbu Dojo. In 1975, he moved to the United States. In the late 70s, he demonstrated for the United Nations peacekeeping forces and for the delegates to the United Nations. Several years after moving to the United States, Saotome Sensei established an Aikido organization, Aikido Schools of Ueshiba, which is recognized by Aikikai Honbu Dojo. For Saotome Sensei, Aikido is a Budo, and this means that its aim is nothing less than the education of human instinct. On this view, the purpose of Aikido is not to prepare us for hurting others, or even for defending ourselves, but to lead us beyond petty selfishness to a state of global concern, respect, and compassion. In 1994, at the celebration of Saotome Sensei's 40th year in Aikido, he was presented with a letter from President Bill Clinton. In the letter, President Clinton commends Saotome Sensei for a lifetime devoted to promoting nobility of spirit and civility of conduct. In a proper grip, the left hand rests at the base of the hilt. There is a space the width of one fist, and the right hand rests just behind the handguard or tsuba. Both hands are wrung inward. Gripping the sword from underneath is a mistake, since it requires too much of the right thumb. In the proper grip, both hands are wrung inward and placed on the handle from the top. Accustomed to training with wooden swords, some Aikidoka place their right hands too far up on the sword or extend their index fingers down the blade. A real sword tsuba would protrude this grip, as of course, with blade sharpness. When there is a space between the tsuba and the right hand, the sword can be moved more freely than when the right hand is pushed up against the tsuba. Taking a proper stance, or kamae, can aid in the integration of body, mind, and spirit, an integration that can help us in our daily lives. Many people think only about the sword's tip, but when we are relaxed, our thought, concentration, and energy move through the sword and flow out the sword's tip. establish this bridge, one closes off an opponent's opportunity for attack. Proper Kamae, with mind, body, and spirit unified, leads to control of the sword. When deflected, the sword quickly and naturally returns to center. Power through the sword originates from a strong center. With a strong center, one is very stable. This is a good example of a proper stance. The knees are relaxed, the shoulder and arms are relaxed, and there is a clean, strong focus. There are many different kamae. In this basic one, called Seigan, the tip is pointed at the opponent's throat, upper lip, or eyes. This is Gedan, or lowered kamae. This basic kamae is Haso Jodan. This is reverse Haso, Haso Gyaku. And this basic kamae is Haso Gedan, lowered Haso. Zuburi are basic, uncomplicated sword movements. In Shomen Zuburi, the weight of the entire body moves with the strike. The sword, the body, mind, and the spirit all move together, and one's energy harmonizes with the movement of the sword. Being razor sharp, the sword cuts. It does not hit or chop. If the sword blade deviates too greatly from vertical, it cannot cut. Also, the swordsman should observe and respect the sword's line. The beginning of the cut must always be relaxed and extended, like casting a fishing line. At the top of the strike, the sword extends out, its power moving through it. The body follows the cut down naturally. The sword, the shoulders, and the hips all stop together. Wearing large helmets, the samurai cannot bring their swords straight overhead to strike. So in old-style suburi, which many beginners find easier than modern-style shomen suburi, the sword is brought to the side of the head, and the cut is diagonal. Here, as in the other cuts, relaxation is important. The shoulders, elbows, and wrists should be relaxed, and the weight of the sword should be used in the cut. In battle, the sword cannot stop. Movement must be flowing and continuous, as illustrated by this suburi, which starts in Haso Gedan position. This next suburi, in which a guard position alternates with a side head strike called Yokomen, illustrates the fluidity with which offense changes to defense, and defense back to offense. In this suburi, thrusting motion, ski, is followed by a shomen cut. Here, as in the other suburi, proper breathing is important. In through the nose, out through the mouth. Here, beginning from Haso Gedan, Satome Sensei cuts diagonally to his left, and the suburi can, of course, be adapted for use from reverse Haso. This, the final suburi of the series, Sotome Sensei begins from a Haso position, cuts diagonally downward, reverses the blade, and then cuts upward. Here, using a wooden sword, Boken, rather than a live blade, Sotome Sensei again demonstrates shomen suburi. While movements of this sort can be practiced alone, they can also be practiced with a training partner in the role of opponent. The point of such exercises is not to compete or even to prepare for competition, but to develop abilities necessary for practicing Aikido, primarily the ability to focus and the ability to harmonize with another person's movement. In this exercise, the partners alternately cut shomen, cuts diagonally, flowing from a cut to the left that begins from hustle position into a cut to the right that begins from reverse hustle. In the paired practice based on Subudi, Tatome Sensei performs diagonal cuts as his partner, Frank Bell, cuts Shomen. The important point in this looping Subudi is relaxed, flowing, continuous movement. In the paired exercise based on this Subudi, Satome Sensei performs the looping movement as his partner once again cuts Shomen. From the time Satome Sensei begins Aso Gedan to the time he returns to this position, his sword has glanced off his partner's sword four times. In this Subudi, Satome Sensei thrusts Ski and then steps back into a defensive position. The paired practice associated with the Subudi clearly illustrates the harmonious nature of these paired practices. This Subudi involves a deflection, not a true strike. In this paired practice, both partners move as in the Subudi. In this movement, Satome Sensei alternates a yokomen strike with a defensive position. There are two paired practices associated with the Subudi. In the first, the partners perform the motions of the Subudi in unison. In the second, one partner makes the Subudi's defensive movement as the other makes his offensive movement, and they then reverse roles. Here the sword moves in large circles. In this paired practice, Satome Sensei moves through the Subudi as his partner repeatedly strikes Shomen. The sword of Aikido is based on principle, not merely on technique, and one of the most important of these principles is marubashi. Literally translated, the term marubashi means log bridge. In the context of samurai swordsmanship, however, marubashi refers to the bridge that is one's life. But on this bridge, a person cannot find safety in retreat, deception, escape, postponement, or evasion. The only path is the narrow bridge on which the enemy approaches. Here, to strive for life is to embrace death. On the other hand, to move straight ahead on a path with disregard for life may lead to survival. Entering directly to the enemy's attack, irimi, one may be able to guide the attack, michibiki, in one stroke cutting through both the enemy's sword and spirit. The term kumi has to do with system, and the term tachi means sword. For studying the set kumitachi patterns, aikidoka can learn about proper distance, angle, timing, and posture, about reacting to other people's movement, and, most important, about unification and communication. Each pattern is a dialogue. Despite the appearances, the participants in the kumitachi are not fighting, or even training to fight, as they might be in arts such as kendo or iaido. They're studying Aikido. The principles underlying Saotome-sensei system, the first five kumitachi are considered primary. Here is the first of these five. One of the participants in kumitachi number one, the one who begins in hasogedan, this is the kumitachi's first move. As his partner strikes shomen, Saotome-sensei illustrates the principle of marubashi by entering directly into the partner's attack. In the entry, Saotome-sensei deflects his partner's sword, but leaves his own on the center line. One participant in the kumitachi strikes shomen, the other enters directly, deflecting the initial shomen attack while creating an opening into which he can thrust. As the thrust develops, the initial attacker shields himself with his sword and then strikes yokomen. The opponent guards his right side, leaving his left side open. The other swordsman strikes into the opening, deflecting the attempt to guard and entering toward his opponent's center. Position is important. Purifying his aggression, the winning swordsman does not in any sense finish off his opponent. On the other side, the defeated swordsman does not simply give up. If the winner becomes overly aggressive, defeated swordsman, who remains focused and aware, can come back to take control of the other sword, perhaps by moving enemy tenka. Defeat, therefore, does not imply complete surrender, and victory does not imply killing or humiliation. For each kumitachi, there are a number of variations, or awasetachi. Saotome-sensei will demonstrate five variations of kumitachi number one now, and three of kumitachis two, three, four, and five later. like that of number one. But as the initial showman strike develops, the defending swordsman shields himself rather than entering. The shielding movement leads directly to a yokoman strike. Guarding against this strike, the initial attacker leaves his left side open. The other swordsman strikes into the opening, deflecting his partner's blade and ending Tsunkumitachi number one. Beginning of Kumitachi number one, concepts of Marubashi and Michibiki are illustrated by a downward strike. Here, in Kumitachi number three, these concepts are illustrated by an upward movement, which deflects a downward shoulder strike. The ending of the Kumitachi is like that of the previous two. The initial moves of Kumitachi number 3 illustrate how defense can flow into offense. In the practice of the Kumitachi, defense and offense are not separate, the one leads into the other. Sometimes, the person who initially attacks allows his partner's upward deflection to move the tip of his sword far off the center line. This is a mistake, as it leaves an opening into which the opponent can strike. It is very important to hold the center. With one sword tip on the center line, one can defend or renew the attack. changes the motion of his sword to protect his leg. A lesson of the Kumihachi is that if we attack blindly or overcommit ourselves to one motion, we may open ourselves to counterattack. The initial showman's strike is overcommitted. The swordsman cannot easily shift to defense. After Saotome Sensei blocks the attack to his leg, his opponent thrusts towards his right side. The defensive movement opens up his left side, and the opponent thrusts into this opening. The Kumitachi ends like the previous three. In the first movement of this Kumitachi, Saotome Sensei strikes from Hasso position in an attempt to deflect his opponent's sword. If the deflecting sword swings through, it leaves an opening. As in similar moves in the previous Kumitachi, the deflection should leave the tip of the sword on the center line so that the sword can thrust directly in. The opponent shields against the thrust and then strikes Yokoman. Saotome Sensei deflects the strike downward, taking care, once again, not to open himself to a second attack. Thank you. Satome-sensei cuts upward, his opponent steps back, and as the opponent cuts do, Satome-sensei reverses his stance. Here is a review of the first 5 kumitachi, followed by a demonstration of the next 10. Tome Sensei insists that in studying the Kumitachi, we are studying Aikido itself. The answer lies in part in the traditional distinction of Satsujinkan from Katsujinkan. While the sword of Satsujinkan is wielded to punish or kill an enemy, the sword of Katsujinkan is wielded with control, to restore order and to protect. From the standpoint of technique, Satsujinkan and Katsujinkan are similar. The difference lies in the swordsman's intention, the human spirit behind the sword. As a result of the difference in intention, the outcome differs. A victory of Satsujinkan leads to destruction, an ending. A victory of Katsujinkan leads not to destruction, but to the possibility of a new beginning. Accordingly, the purpose of Kumitachi is not to reveal points of technique. Their purpose is to manifest Katsujinkan, a spirit which transcends hostility and which therefore goes beyond traditional martial technique.